Welcome to Discovering. Join me tonight for a look at managing our UP forest for wildlife.
I'm here today for UPSA trying to show that game species management is different than economic management in aspen stands or any other type of timber that we're going to harvest in the UP.
Then Lake Michigan perch fishing. And we'll find out how to shrink wrap a boat. A lot more tonight, so sit back and put your feet up. It's time for Discover.
The secret streams that flow beneath the cliffs of colored stone. Forests thick and healthy with birch and pine and oak. Surrounded by the greatest lakes this world has ever known. The black bear's awesome presence as he roams the hills and fields. Call of the timber wolf, the loon's lonesome trill. The eagle soaring high above, the trout lies deep and still. These are what I treasure, the only way I measure feelings that I have for this fine land. There is so much to discover when you're a longtime lover of northern Michigan.
$311,361 friends and neighbors collectively called UPers. Inhabit 16,452 square miles of recreational paradise known simply as the UP. Whether you're a logger, a farmer, a construction worker, a police or conservation officer, or a government official, whether or not you hunt or fish, we all have one common responsibility. We are its caretakers. In the UP, the words land management and wildlife go hand in hand. I talked with Rory Mattson of the Upper Peninsula Sportsmen's Alliance to get some insight on land management and how it relates to wildlife here in the UP.
Well, right behind me here, there's an old cut line. Everything to my left was cut about 24 years ago, so it's a younger stand. On my right, this is an older stand. This was probably cut maybe 50, 52 years ago. Conservation District owns this land now, and we're gonna be managing this property under early successional management. Basically for game species and recreation for individuals and a rec area that we're gonna build that people can come to. The reason you wanna turn this over is when you're looking at aspen type, and that's early successional type species, you got your birch, you got everything else that goes with that, and small balsams and things like that. It makes excellent habitat for game species. And we're talking deer, we're talking grouse, we're talking woodcock, hare, bear, turkey. These type of things that individuals seem to like to recreate during the hunting season. Aspen and associated species, like mostly balsam and that, when they start to get 30 years and older, they tend to be at maturity and you're gonna start to lose the size class that you have there. Also, the spruce budworm is really coming into the Upper Peninsula this year. A lot of people complaining about that. When you start to get spruce and balsam around that age too, it's more susceptible to the budworm forest health issues that you have on it. UPSA is working with the DNR on right now is to not let aspen rotations at 50 years, which has almost been traditionally. And they're talking maybe going down to 40. We're trying to get them to go down to 30. And the reason for that, once these aspen areas get to 25, 30 years old, the quality it gets reduced a lot. So you have excellent habitat for the game species and other species that use it. Basically, you do a clear cut, you got about 1 year till things start to grow back up. So from age one till about 24, 25, it's in really excellent or good range of habitat. And actually, it starts to grow out of that. So what's been happening in the past, basically because of just the logging practices, half the whole duration of the stand sat in either medium or poor quality habitat. Now with the new harvesting equipment, you can actually literally get as many cords on a good site index as you could if you waited till 50 years. So the conservation district here, we will start harvesting our stands on rotation, depending, we'll vary the sizes, and so the block of land that we own, we'll have many in different age classes on the aspen type. But we're going to try to harvest things anywhere between a 25 and a 35 year old cycle on all the aspen land that we have. And I'm encouraging that to private landowners, and we're going to hopefully encourage that to the state of Michigan on game purchase lands, which should be managed for game. Basically, game species thrive in early successional habitat. And if you're looking at the aspen type, when the aspen gets about 30 years and older, what ends up happening is it turns from excellent in good habitat to medium to poor the older it gets. So the big question was, in the old days, you could not harvest aspen by the chainsaw when it was as thick as dog hair on a dog's back, as it used to be called. Too small, it took too long, it was just a lot of effort to harvest it. With today's modern machinery, the big question comes to, can you do it? Well, here we're standing in an aspen stand that's 30 years old. You can see that there isn't much food source for deer, for turkey, and things that can't fly. So for deer range improvement, when you get to 30 years old, you should consider harvesting these stands. And this one here, if you look at it, you'll see that the aspen actually is probably averaging about 4 stick. Some of it's even 5 stick. So you're going to average 4 stick in this stand. So these type of stands now can be cut. Here we are in a stand that was actually 1 acre in size. It was measured out and marked to be a perfect acre. And the reason we did this was to see if a logger comes in to 30-year-old aspen, that's averaging 3-4 sticks, can a logger economically make money and harvest? And the answer was yes, can probably make better money than if you're harvesting the 50 to 60 year old aspen. Now look at the food value here. This was harvested at 28, and look at 2 years, the growth, the regeneration. You have aspen coming up, you have cherry coming up, you have raspberries, you have all kinds of forbs underneath the ground. The food source is extremely high here compared to almost zero unless you're a giraffe in the other stand. This site was done through a cost share through the Natural Resource Conservation Service. That's a federal agency, and it was done for wildlife habitat. It was done through a woodcock initiative. That money came to NRCS, to the Delta County area, and we came out to landowners and found areas where we believed we could increase the habitat for woodcock, therefore increasing the populations of woodcock and grouse. A machine came in, one of those bobcat skid steers with a big rotary head, mowed the tag alters down, and basically set succession back. And by doing that, this will increase the woodcock use of this area, the grouse, rabbit, and obviously the deer in that. You can see raspberries coming up in this area that never were, and other type of vegetation. Before, this was a mature tag alter, and there was basically nothing underneath it, and it was just a dense overstory, very low to the ground, nothing coming up. And you can see now all the vegetation that's coming up on the ground. This is 2 years old, and the animals are definitely using it a lot more. So how do you manage for game species basically along rivers, lakes, streams, riparian areas? Basically, it's not all about cutting. It's not all about aspen. You have to have mesic, depending on how you want to pronounce it, conifer areas, because these animals are also going to need shelter from the wind and the cold during the winter. So you want cedar areas, and you want to be able to retain those, or hemlock, or sometimes you can use different pines depending on the conifers. But areas that are lowland probably should be retained for riparian buffers. You can go into them depending on what type of a hardwood content you have. But upland areas that are adjacent to rivers or streams, if that river or stream, basically it's very easy. Try to find out if it's a trout stream, what that means. It's cold water versus warm water rivers. This old fallacy about, you know, retaining these buffers right up to the river, sometimes for wildlife, is not the best thing. Riparian buffers are fantastic. They're used as corridors, things like that, but there's no reason you can't harvest up to a river too if you have the right site conditions, you have the right species, and things like that. And a lot of times that'll even help, like woodcock or other things You'll actually increase your populations by doing this. So you need somebody to come onto your property who knows about wildlife, who knows about tree species, and how to manage them and how to harvest them correctly. You need a few things. You need a home. That's your cedar areas, that's your hemlock areas, that's the cover areas. Not areas that you provide cover like black spruce sometimes, those aren't very good. Black ash, they lose their leaves, you know, and they're just, there's a lot of wind that can go through there, a lot of snow still goes through there. So find these conifer areas in the lowlands. You can also develop them on the uplands, but you can also harvest these certain riparian areas next to rivers on uplands. But you want the house, the home, you want food, you want water, and if you create this, you will have wildlife. This road was seeded down by the Conservation District basically as a walking trail, not necessarily to hunt, also for recreation, basically to view wildlife. And obviously what's going to be attracted to the clovers are going to be mostly game species, and you know, you're going to have deer, you'll have grouse on these type of trails. You can occasionally get a bear out eating clovers. They like to eat the tops. And these are things individuals like to see. These are excellent hunting trails, and they also provide a very good food source depending on what type of clovers that you use from spring through fall. These aren't much good in the winter. I know there's a big push, you know, for food plots and walking trails, and these are all excellent things, but you have to do the forest management, wildlife management habitat with that. Otherwise, all you're doing is creating summer range. And one of our critical types of habitat that we need to work on, all of us, is winter range. But these are excellent for landowners to put in, and you really get to see the animals a lot more than if you didn't have these type of areas.
Is there really such a thing as bad luck? I'm not superstitious. Black cats, busted mirrors, and walking under ladders doesn't bother me in the least. But when it comes to fishing, there's reason for concern. I've taken the blame for many a fishless day by many a disgruntled fisherman. I've blown that theory off many times, but in hindsight, there does indeed seem to be a pattern. I recently had the opportunity to hit the waters of Lake Michigan with a guy I like to call Salmon Jack. I call him Salmon Jack because Jack catches salmon, under any circumstances. As I hopped aboard for a salmon-filled evening out of Manistique, I felt the obligation to at least warn Salmon Jack about my history in the luck department. We all laughed it off and set sail. It was a bit windy, but nothing that would give cause for worry. Windy enough, though, that I packed my camera away for the journey to the salmon grounds. That would be the last the camera would see of that trip. Several miles into our journey, the wind picked up a bit, and then rapidly, a bit more. This continued until we turned the boat and headed back for the safety of the harbor. As the wind continued to increase, I could see it in Salmon Jack's eyes. There was that look again. That bad luck indeed look. First time all year, he said. First time on the water without coming back with fish. Now, we technically didn't get skunked since we never put a line in the water. I did take a bit of relief in that. A couple days later, Salmon Jack called with a new plan. We'd head for Escanaba. Not sure if the fish will be there, he said. But it was late, Esky was close, and the weather was perfect. I brought a buddy of mine along. He's known as the Black Cloud because bad luck seems to follow him wherever he goes. I figured I couldn't go wrong with this plan. Either we'd cancel each other out and the luck would swing in the direction of good, or I could blame him for the bad luck if indeed things swung in that direction. We cleared the harbor and it started. First just a breeze, then a wind. Small waves, then white caps, then rollers.
Yeah, I'd say it's building up, not slowing down.
In the time it took to make the short trip to our destination, water began to spill over the bow.
Pretty rough out today.
We stuck it out long enough to conclude that for some unknown reason, the fish were not interested. No matter. In the end, it's still called skunked. First time this year, Jack said. First time. There was that look again. Well, enough time had passed, I guess, where the bad luck theory had worn off. Or maybe he just wanted to test out the possibility one more time. I don't know, but Salmon Jack was on the phone again. This time it was a sure thing. He had a friend who happened onto some perch and was slaying him for the last few days. Clouds of them, he said. All I could see was a fish fry. I was already making out the list of who I was going to invite. Patty came along just to make sure we'd have enough perch to cover the guest list.
Now we got to keep looking around finally will find a school of them, and then you can get on them and anchor up and fish them. But you can spend a lot of time fishing for nothing if you don't have a good number of fish there, you know. And there's a lot of water out here to try to find them in. So you just keep on watching on here until you mark a school of them. Then you try to stick with them as best as you can, anyhow.
The lines were in, and it was time for action. Could it be true? Where's the cloud? My fish fry. Well, the perch did eventually bite. We did indeed find some perch. A cloud? Well, our cloud only held 8 keepers. I guess a small cloud is better than a black one. Was it bad luck or just fishing? Who knows? As the night moved in, all thoughts of a fish fry faded away. All in all, it was a great evening on the water. Jack hasn't called me in a while. I'm guessing he's out of town though, because I've been calling him and nobody answers. Ever. As the days grow shorter and the leaves begin to change, there's a feeling in the air that serves to remind us of what's to come. It's not too early to start thinking about preparing for the upcoming winter. A great way to protect some of your valuable toys is shrink wrapping. I've always wondered exactly how it was done, so I paid a visit to my friends at Redline Sport Marine in Norway to find out.
Today we're going to do a winterization on a 60 horsepower Mercury EFI motor, 4-stroke. Drain refill the lower unit, change engine oil filter on it. Get it ready for winter. And then we're gonna do a shrink wrap on the whole thing. So I guess the first thing I wanna do is get the lower unit draining. While I'm doing that, I'll check for a fishing line in here. I don't see, this thing looks pretty good. Put this back together quick, a little grease on the splines. Good to see there was no water or moisture in this lower unit.
I usually run the engine, warm the engine up, change oil filter on it, put the oil in it, start it back up, run it for a while. I've already put stabilizer in the fuel tank itself. I've ran it for about 5 minutes or so on a flush. So basically the engine's had an oil change, lower unit's done on it. We've greased all the pivot points on it, changed the filter, drained the fuel tank on it. So it's, the engine's about ready to be put away. We'll disconnect the battery before we start shrink wrapping. We've got the pontoon all banded off now. We're about ready to pull the shrink wrap over and shrink it on there. Each boat is different, you know, like this pontoon, we lower the tops on them, we take the windshields off, we get all the furniture in the right position. That way, in case something does happen, it doesn't break any of the furniture or poke through the seats. Or this one, we're able to just lay the top down. Most of the time, we gotta take the top right off, turn them, put them inside. Same with fishing boats. A lot of times you gotta take the windshields off and trolling motors and a few other things. All right, usually what I do is I line it up so we're centered. Or if I got a lot of extra, I'll pull it to one side. Slide it underneath the one that I wrapped the whole boat around with. It's very important to get this stuff tight. Otherwise it just doesn't shrink right. All right, that side's ready to be tacked together. What I'm doing is adhering the piece that I folded around. I'm heating it up and then tapping it so it sticks together. Now we'll go to the other side and do the same thing. Now as I do this side, I usually pull down on it a little bit so it's a little taut on it, a little tighter. Very important to keep an eye on your flame more than the torch. You can burn a big hole in the shrink wrap. You can burn the carpet if it's exposed carpet somewhere, or side bunks. Usually I'll cover them first on a fishing style boat. Shrink wrapping's not just for boats either. We do everything. I had a lady come in, we did furniture for us. There's lots of uses for this. Cover your snowmobile, done hot tub covers. I mean, you name it. It's a good way to go if you want to protect something. Especially if you got to travel with it. It's very important to watch your flame and the material itself. When it starts getting kind of glassy looking, you better be moving along, otherwise you're gonna have a big hole start right away. The good benefits of shrink wrapping is, one, it's tight, it's waterproof, versus putting a tarp on there. This you almost don't need to maintain at all, unless we have a real heavy snow you wanna look at. But the supports are the biggest thing in there, that they're tall enough so it just slides off. A nice sunny day with the blue shrink wrap, the snow just slides right off it. From here, I'll go around and like all these little corners here, you can see where it's actually starting to tear because there's a piece here. I'll tape all these individual corners. We get up there, we put vents, one on each end, air vents in there. Like I said, there's also mildew bags I already put in there. So hopefully in the springtime, if everything's dry and that, you don't have any mold issues at all. Take the cover off, start the engine, away you go. Ready to go boating.
Well, that's it for this week. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week right here on Upper Michigan's very own Discovering.